Welcome to the Big Four Accounting Firms podcast, brought to you by BigFourAccountingFirms.com. In today's podcast, I wanted to discuss the PwC leak scandal in Australia. It's pretty huge news. Got a request to do this. Been meaning to cover this, but just been busy, and also the story just keeps blowing up beyond belief. And it's just another Big Four scandal. We've had some big ones this year. We've had EY call off their split. We've had KPMG audit a bunch of failed banks. And now we have PwC screwing up in Australia. There's a little bit with Deloitte in China, but Deloitte has not had a huge one recently that I could think of. But we'll see on that. Maybe I just haven't been following the news as closely, but this scandal, I wanted to cover it. I'm not going to be the best source for the news part of it, but I wanted to discuss it a little bit. And then I wanted to discuss why it happened and how to prevent it. So first let's discuss a little bit of background. And you can probably find better background from the Australia Financial Review and other Australian newspapers, and then The Guardian. I think The Guardian was one of the first ones that blew this thing up. But what happened here, and what makes it unique, is that PwC leaked a bunch of internal discussions and plans from the Australia tax, legislators. I guess you'd say they were drafting tax legislation in Australia. And what happened was PwC was engaged by the government to help them draft this legislation. Basically, the reason you'd want to do that is because, you know, the Big Four is really good at helping their clients avoid taxes. Essentially, PwC would help Australia with everything they're seeing taxpayers do with regards to avoiding taxes. Now, why PwC would want to do that, I don't know. And don't get me wrong, the Big Four accounting firms help a lot of tax offices around the world and come up with new legislation. But you obviously don't want to make it too good to where you can't help your clients get around it. And so what PwC was doing here, I guess they thought they were going to finesse the Australian government and get all their plans and then just sell the plans to their clients. And that's what they did. And what happened, why this thing is steadily blowing up, is because PwC essentially tried to cover that up. And there all of this came from one partner. I guess his name was Peter Collins at PwC. He was the one getting this information. And then he said, "This is for your eyes only," when he was discussing it with his partners at PwC. And all of this came out through emails that the Australian legislature's got and they've released. And that's how it's pulled in more people. And what it ultimately did is it led to the CEO of PwC Australia to resign because he got caught up in this whole thing too. And he was trying to make it seem smaller than it was. And what PwC tried to make it seem like at first was like, this is an Australia only thing. But it wasn't. What happened was that PwC shipped this over to North America, where they sold this to tech companies. They sold, hey, like we have an inside view inside of changing Australia legislation, and we want to sell you some services. And they essentially sold it to 14 companies, and they only made a couple million bucks, supposedly. We don't know what's going to come out of this. I think it has to be more, or I don't know if it could be that much more, because we're talking about Australia here. You know, Australia is not like a juggernaut country where there's a bunch of huge companies headquartered. So I think this thing is being overblown a little. But what happened here was PwC should not have done this, because they signed an agreement with the Australian government saying they were going to keep it confidential, and you're not supposed to do this stuff. This is very big, and the problem is it's partners that are involved, and it's partners at the most senior levels, because you have to think of if you're shipping this globally, you have to go through multiple layers of review. And that's what these emails show. And then to take it to North America, it's even higher. Now, was it worth it? No, because PwC only made a couple million. And I think that's where the Australian government is blowing it up more than it needs to be. The Australian government is making it seem like it's the end of the world regarding PwC, but PwC didn't make that much money off of this. $2 million when they make $45 billion plus a year, or $50 billion, I'm sorry, a year. That's a drop in the bucket. That's nothing. Now, PwC's problem is they've tarnished their global brand off of this for a couple million dollars. But that is the fatal flaw in the big four accounting firm structure, the way they're structured. And I'll talk about that more in a little bit. And another thing that PwC has risked is that there's a lot of governmental work in Australia, not just helping with tax legislation, but overall. I think this, I saw something like $2 billion a year or over a certain time period. And there's hundreds of millions that go to consultants. And Australia is considering cutting PwC off from that. Now, is that necessarily material to the PwC global revenue? Maybe not. Is that material to PwC Australia's revenue? Yes, it is. And so PwC has risked their global brand and they've risked their local brand in Australia. And so what's happened because of the PwC Australia CEO resigning is PwC, the global firm that lends out their brand, is getting involved in Australia. I mean, they have to at this point because they have to contain it because it's not only pulled in PwC Australia, it's pulled in the global firm. And PwC has to do, they have to get there and plan how they're going to rebrand this, make it look not as bad as they are, as it is. And then they're going to have to, they're going to have to say that they've implemented new standards. They've changed their ethics in the country. And there's Australian legislators that are saying that this can't happen because, you know, there's so many executives that are still at the firm that were there through this. And I don't disagree with that, but I think that's going a little bit too far. Sometimes these governments try to just paint with a broad brush and they just want to eliminate these firms. But you can't really eliminate the big four accounting firms because the big four accounting firms are a huge size. And if you don't have them, you're not going to have certain consultants to do a lot of this government work that needs to get done. Because a lot of this governmental work that needs to get done is on an ad hoc basis. It's not ongoing. It's something that needs to get done that the government wants to get done. And the big four can hire people really quick. They could let people go really quick. So they have the flexibility. And you need to move this work around from the big four accounting firms, from firm to firm, so that way you don't get stuff like this happening all the time. Because if there was only one big four accounting firm or you only gave it to a couple, then this would be a lot more common. So next, let's cover why this might happen or why does this happen in the big four accounting firms. This does happen because of the structure. It's a firm of partnerships, global partnerships, and the partners have to meet their metrics. And this one partner, he saw it as a way to advance himself. He had inside information. He wanted to get out ahead of tax planning. And because that's a way to distinguish himself from other firms, is by getting ahead of this and start selling it to their tech clients right away versus letting the other firms get to this at the same time when the legislation came out later. Now, is this a big deal? I don't think so, because most big four have people with inside these tax legislatures, and they know the legislation before it comes out. They already know it. So I think that's probably why this guy did what he did, because he knew that that was the case. But to actually be doing that while you're doing work for the government, that's what makes it terrible. Especially when you have to take so many trainings around this stuff all the time. And that's what's already coming out around this. It's just more and more training. And that's what we've discussed on this podcast over the years. that there's limited penalties for the people that do this stuff. And the people that ultimately end up paying are the people that do the good work, because you have to take more trainings. You have to sign off on more ethical statements. There's just a lot more regulation of existing good people than there is of punishment of the people that did this. Now, if the governments want to punish the senior people that were involved in this very harshly, that makes sense to me. But that's probably not going to happen. It's probably going to be more of just more statements from the Big Four, more regulations on top of existing regulations that are already covering this. Not only regulations, but also PwC's internal policies definitely already cover this. All the Big Four firms already cover all this stuff. But that's why in the U.S., the Big Four, they have very stringent requirements when you work on government projects for things just like this. So it's just that PwC was very boneheaded, and it just shows how very bad their leadership is, that they let this go global because it was not worth it. But that's the problem when it's a firm of partners, is they're very short-sighted, and they're only worried about their P&L and their bonus. They're not really worried about the firm brand. This amount of money they won off of this, and the amount of money that you can make off of Australian tax planning, is just not significant and not worth it. But obviously, these executives did not do that analysis. There was nobody that put their foot down fast enough to stop this. And that's what the shame is. But I'll let the Australian legislatures in on a secret. This isn't uncommon. This unethical behavior in the Big Four accounting firms and accounting is not uncommon. And really, the way that you get around this is not what they're about to do, or just it's the Big Four are corrupt, blah, blah, blah. And I've said it on this podcast over and over. The way you get around this is you reward people that are ethical, and you reward whistleblowers. Like, I saw something recently about the SEC. They handed out the largest award ever. It's like over like $200 million or something like that. That's how you stop this. Because it's very hard to report this type of behavior internally and externally. And even when you report it externally to regulators, it takes forever for them to penalize wrongdoers. And you have to have rock solid slam dunk evidence for them to even do this. There needs to be rewards internally for ethical behavior, for setting a standard of ethical behavior. You know, it needs to be less now about ESG and all this other stuff for the Big Four accounting firms, because honestly, these scandals at the Big Four are getting bigger and bigger, and they're more potential for firm like to destroy the firm brand in certain countries if the Big Four accounting firms don't get this under control. And there's a big lack of ethical behavior in accounting, because there's no real reward for it, especially in the Big Four accounting firms, because there's more reward on top line revenue. That's what it is. And so you're going to get as much as top line revenue for your share of the Big Four accounting firm. If you're a partner, you want to get as much revenue allocated to you as possible. You know, you care less about the firm brand than you do about your own P&L. So you're willing to risk the firm's brand to get yourself short-term gain. And that's what the partners here did, obviously, because it's going to destroy many of their careers and their brands, the firm's brand. Tim Ryan's not going to be able to, you know, write one of his nice little LinkedIn stories about this one. There's no getting around this one. This one is terrible. And the more that PwC tries to sugarcoat this, and then later it comes out that it's worse, the worse off they're going to be. This is going to be a case study from the Big Four of how to reshape your brand. I thought EY was having a bad year. I thought KPMG was having a bad year. And then PwC showed up and said, hey, hold on, you know, we're going to outdo both of you. This is the worst, like one of the worst things that that you can think of. It's not that big of a deal when you dig into the details, but when you put yourself out there as the utmost height of ethical behavior, and it turns out you are the complete opposite behind the scenes, people lose trust. The Australian government has lost complete trust in PwC. And it's going to do damage to their global brand. So it's going to be interesting to see how PwC continues to respond to this. But I don't think it's going to be good, because the Big Four accounting firms lie. These partners lie, because they're so used to being operating politically and maneuvering politically and putting up smoke and mirrors, that the only thing they know how to do is to lie and sugarcoat things. But in this case, they've done that, and the government has just keeps on coming up with more behavior about how they've tried to cover this up. So there's a lot of potential hazards ahead for PwC, but we'll keep an eye on this. I'll probably keep talking more on what the Big Four can do to change up their behavior going forward to prevent this. But that's what I wanted to cover with the PwC Australia leak scandal. So make sure to subscribe to this podcast to keep track of this stuff. And thank you for listening, and check out the show notes for useful links. Thanks for listening.